spirit of reconciliation, we acknowledge that we live, work, and play on the traditional territories of the Blackfoot Confederacy, Siksika, Kainai, Piikani, the Tsuut'ina, the Stoney Nakoda Nations, Bearspaw, Chiniki, Wesley, the Métis Nation Region 3, and all people who make their homes in this Treaty 7 region of Southern Alberta. We welcome you today to this online worship of St. Thomas United Church and Foothills United Church. We are grateful for the affirming values which St. Thomas embodies as they live out their inclusive welcome to every and all, regardless of age, ethnic, cultural, or spiritual background, gender identity, sexual orientation, family composition, and physical or mental capabilities. We believe that all people are sacred in the eyes of God, welcome at God's table, and entitled to full and equal participation in the life of the church. And we will work to show our understanding of God's world as a place of diversity and justice by our actions and witness to the world. This morning, we light our Christ candle. We light the Christ candle as a symbol of Christ here during this time of worship and with us always. And now let us join together in our introit, More Voices, number 92, Like a Rock.
Please join with me in our call to worship. Your part is in yellow. God, as we come this morning to gather in your presence, we have come to hear the story of Jesus, to be reminded of your love, to share the good news together, and to proclaim Christ is risen. Amen. Please join us as we say our opening prayer in unison. Let's pray together. God of love, we come before you this morning humbled by the realities of the empty cross. Help us to take time this morning to hear once again your message of love and hope that is told on that first Easter morning. Amen. So as we continue our worship, please let us sing together, singing Voices United 561, Take Up Your Cross.
Take up your cross, the Savior said, if you would my disciple be. Take up your cross with willing heart, and humbly follow after me. Take up your cross, let not its weight fill your weak spirit with the strength shall bear your spirit up, and brace your heart and nerve your arm. Take up your cross, heed not the shame, nor let your foolish pride rebel. Your Savior once accepted death upon a cross on Calvary's hill. Thank you.
Our reading today is Philippians 2, verses 1 to 11. If our life in Christ means anything to you, if love or the spirit that we have in common, or any tenderness or sympathy can persuade you at all, then be united in your conventions and united in your love with a common purpose and a common mind. That is the one thing that will make me completely happy. There must be no competition among you, no conceit, but everybody is to be humble. Value others over yourselves, each of you thinking of the interests of others before your own. Your attitude must be the same as that of Jesus Christ. Christ thought in the image of God, did deem equality with God something to be clung to. Instead, became completely empty and took on the image of oppressed humankind. Born into the human condition, found in the likeness of human being, Jesus was this humble, obeying, accepting death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God highly exalted Christ and gave to Jesus the name above every other name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee must be in the heavens, and in the heavens, on the earth and under the earth, and every tongue proclaim to the glory of God. Jesus Christ reigns supreme. This is the witness of the church. Thanks be to God.
This week marks the beginning of our summer series on symbols. Throughout the summer, we'll be looking at a variety of symbols and how we relate and or engage with them as Christians. The first symbol we are looking at is that of the empty cross. A familiar symbol, and one that many around the globe can easily identify as a Christian symbol. But one that still brings questions from both within the Christian community and from without. The cross in the early church, surprisingly, was not a very popular symbol for Jesus' followers. And for a persecuted group of disciples, there might have been a good reason. When Roman officials chose to put an individual to death on the cross, it was a slow, painful, and shameful way to die. A death for criminals. This was not usually a death sentence given to Roman citizens, but one that was frequently used as punishment for slaves, foreigners, disgraced soldiers, political activists, and later Christians, and as a deterrent to anyone else. Sharing the account of the crucified Messiah would have been sensational for a captive audience. But perhaps using the cross as a symbol would have highlighted Jesus' utter shame for a Gentile or Jew at the time, without any context to put it into perspective. The cross does not actually really emerge as a Christian symbol until the 4th century, when Constantine the Great is reported by Christian historian Eusebius of Caesarea to have received both a vision in the sky and a dream with a message from Jesus to fight the Battle of Malvian Bridge under the image of the cross. Before the battle, it is reported that Constantine had his soldiers' shields marked with the symbol, and Malvian Bridge decisively to claim the title of Emperor of Rome. This battle is linked with Constantine's conversion to Christianity and the end of Christian persecution by Rome, and the movement of the Christian faith to becoming a state religion. With this newly found freedom, Christians were able to worship safely. And with that, pilgrims began to travel to the Holy Land to visit holy sites and to see holy relics. Constantine's mother, Helena, who oversaw the recovery of holy sites, is traditionally credited with finding the relic of the true cross. The founding of the True Cross, theologian Andrea Antonin Pitcher states, leads to the veneration of the empty cross itself, which most likely led to its use as a Christian symbol. Constantine also banned the use of crucifixion as a form of death penalty. And with that, the cross moved from a symbol of grotesque death and shame to one of victory over death. While the early crosses used as symbols were empty, by the 6th century, the crucifix begins to emerge. The idea was that the person could meditate on the image of Christ on the cross to understand the suffering that Jesus endured out of love for us. These crucifixes are common in the Catholic and Eastern Orthodox Church, but can also be found in Lutheran and Anglican denominations as well. As Protestant denominations continued to emerge, there was a desire not to focus the symbol of the cross on the death of Jesus, possibly even to distance itself from the Catholic practice of icons in worship, but to place the theological focus on Jesus' resurrection. The cross is empty because Jesus is risen. This morning's text is helpful in placing the importance of the cross within our faith tradition, and not just listing it as a means by which Jesus died. Here you have Paul, a Roman citizen in the early days of the church, who is unabashedly speaking to those whom he has witnessed to, who unabashedly speaks to those whom he has witnessed to and established communities of faith with about Jesus' death on the cross and the mystery of Good Friday and Easter. For Paul, he would have known firsthand the shame of Jesus' death for the original listeners of his public witness and subsequent letters. And yet he turned the table on what Christ's death meant for Christ's followers. Paul, writing on Jesus' death and resurrection, aligns Jesus' death and therefore life with those who were the lowest in society, the rejected, and the outsiders. Jesus was not a Roman citizen afforded the rights of a citizen, but Jesus faced the death of a subjugated and marginalized group. Paul did not shy away from this fact in his preaching. In this morning's text, Paul speaks of unity in faith that is about understanding the love of Jesus as the Son of God, who models a different way of being in the world. This is a God who cares for all and who seeks for people to lay their own selfish ambitions aside in favor of looking out for the well-being of all. For Paul, the cross is a message of hope, one that refocuses us away from ourselves and toward God and God's love for all creation. What does this mean for us today within our own context? It means that the image of the cross can be used to meditate on the fact that through the mystery of Good Friday and the resurrection of Easter, that God has overcome shame and death. That the empty cross can remind us that God is at work here and now. That the cross stands empty, and that we too can let go of shame and death through faith. The empty cross reminds us that the mystery of Good Friday and Easter Sunday are connected, and that without one, there is not the other. It is an important reminder to us as Western privileged followers of Christ today. It can be easy to want to separate the two, to focus on Easter. But without Good Friday, it would only be a portion of the picture. It would tell us that God was triumphant, but would not demonstrate God's aligning with those who are marginalized and abused, even in death. There's power in hope that in the message and a challenge to all of us in privilege to remember. We are called to unity in Christ, to care and to look out for the other, and not to a self-other binary that makes unity a tool of conformity and dominance. We have been over the last year reminded of our tendency as humans to live into a self-other binary, and to look out for those with and to look to those with money and resources as models of success. We often look out for our own self-interests, and yet the empty cross as a symbol tells a counter-narrative that helps us to remain focused. It firmly locates the story of Jesus within the Good Friday and Easter account. So as we navigate the next number of years and we learn to listen better, to create change that brings about the end of systematic racism, as we look at new ways of being church in the world today, this image of the empty cross can still help to ground us. It can be a symbol that reminds us that there is hope, that Easter did come, and that God's love is still at work in the world. The cross can help remind us of Jesus' model of humility that does not seek to minimize the individual, but one that encourages us to open ourselves up to others. This week, as we go out into the world, I invite us all to meditate on the empty cross. The history of the symbol of the cross is rich and complex. But even within this fact, we hear the foundational account of Good Friday and the Easter story of our faith tradition. The empty cross has the power to convey hope. How will we open ourselves up to this message? And how will it change who we will be in the world? Amen.
To the near God, they prayed.
this time, we recognize the gifts of God's people that enable the work of the church both in our community and in our world. We celebrate the giving of your treasure, but acknowledge the giving of your time and your talent as well. We give thanks for all those that continue to support the work of both churches through continuing to mail your donations to the churches, by supporting our grocery gift card program, and by participating in the pre-authorized remittance giving program. I would invite anyone else who would like to support this community of faith to do so on the Donate Now button on our website. I invite us into a time of prayer. Let us pray. God, we give thanks for all the gifts offered up through the time, talent, and treasure of these communities. And we give thanks that through these gifts, we can continue to live out the story of love modeled to us through the person of Jesus. Amen. As we move into a time of prayer, let us prepare our hearts for prayer by singing More Voices 154, Deep in Our Hearts, verse 1. Let us move into a time of prayer for ourselves, for our communities, and for the world. Let us pray. God of the resurrection and hope, we admit the cross generates mixed emotions. We've struggled with this symbol. For some, it can give great comfort. For others, it is a symbol of execution, plain and simple. Amidst the ongoing struggle, the cross has evolved into Christianity's symbol for hope. And it is this hope for which we give great thanks. Each evening we rest our weary bodies, accepting that the day is a completed whole. It is the limit of our sorrows and efforts. Every morning we awake with the hope that this day is a new beginning of our life. And throughout each hour, minute, and second, may we be reminded of your mercy, a mercy that is ever new with every new moment. In every breath, your hope enters our bodies. In every movement, your energy pulses through our veins. In every time of rest and silence, your voice speaks loud and clear. Words of encouragement, gestures of acceptance, feelings of embracing love. May we know and accept your strength so that we can pass it on to others. With your strength and love, we lift up those who are in need of prayer, those struggling with love for themselves and others, those dealing with mental health concerns. We pray for those seeking housing and those who are feeling unsafe. We pray for those without hope, those in need of healing, and those grieving and mourning loss. May our prayers reach those in need and give them comfort and support to persevere with hope. We enter now into a time of silence where we can, without fear, share all those things that are on our hearts, lifting up the people we know are burdened, the illnesses we know are serious, the situations we know are dire. Be with any and all who are in need, we pray. Most hopeful creator of all, we give thanks for these times of unloading that give us the strength to carry on and share the hope that is symbolized in the empty cross of resurrection. We continue to pray with enthusiasm as we sing the Lord's Prayer.
Let us join responsively in our commissioning. The cross is empty, and our hearts are full. Risen, Jesus walked amongst the disciples and called them to go out into the world. Today, we too hear that call and proclaim with joy the mystery of Easter to the world. Amen. And so now, in joy, let us leave this time of worship, knowing God's love, inspired by the Spirit to live out the ways modeled to us in Jesus. Amen.